take me backstage, slime me, Amanda show, roast me in the chair.
Gack me.
Pickle. Yeah. Whatever. Gack me is crazy.
I know.
Gack me is crazy.
Welcome to It's Giving Sucks, the podcast where the line between the intriguing and the unsettling is blurred. Every episode, we dive deep into the world of true crime and scandals, bringing you the most suspicious and jaw-dropping stories from around the world. There's so much crazy stuff going on, and we need to talk about all of it. Bizarre happenings, scams, cults, crimes, or controversial figures, we're here to dissect it all. Nothing is off limits. Join us as we unpack and comprehend this episode's story. And remember, if it's giving sus, stay curious and stay skeptical.
Warning, this episode contains discussion of extremely sensitive topics. Please check the show notes for more details before proceeding. We ask that you please take caution when listening. If you or someone you know is in need of resources, please check the episode notes for more information. Thank you for listening.
Let's get into the documentary. There's a lot of allegations. We start off with the two women who were writers. Their names are Christy and Jenny. They were put in really weird situations. And this was new to me. I don't know if they have spoken out before, but I put a couple notes of the most like things that stuck out.
Yeah.
I'm sure
there's a lot.
There is. And the first thing, and we already touched on it, was the splitting of the salary. I've never even heard of that.
They're women. That's literally the reason. That's ridiculous.
And I was really glad to hear in the documentary that those two like formed an alliance and were really, really like in it together. And they were complete strangers. And they're like, yep, you're working with her. You guys splitting a salary. Good luck.
I mean, imagine if they were against each other, though. Like,
That's what I'm saying.
Like, what good would have that have done for either of them?
Well, I mean, honestly, with the disgusting dynamic in that writer's room, Dan or anybody could have pin them together against each other too.
Absolutely.
So I'm just glad that they had each other. And when Christy left first and then Jenny eventually left, like they went after him together, right? Yeah. So I'm just glad that they had each other. Oh my God, the things that this man made them do. Dan put a dare out, a challenge that if Christy could eat 2 pints of ice cream in 30 minutes, he would give her $300. And she needed that money, she said.
I mean, yeah, you're splitting a salary.
We're sharing a salary.
Probably an unlivable salary in where? California, in LA, yeah. Where they're working, Hollywood? That's crazy.
Mm-mm.
No.
Insane.
Insane.
So she eats ice cream. She was sick. But why? Like, why? Why? What's the challenge? And then what did they say? Dan offered like $50 if someone like killed a fly or something.
I don't even know. Just weird shit.
Just weird. I mean, just why? Weird environment, right? Split the salary. You're women. You're less than. Eat this ice cream. Make me laugh and I'll give you $300. Sick. Sick power. The money. Twisted. Disgusting.
Mm-hmm. Using these women's careers.
Over their head.
Yeah. Blackmail, essentially.
Christy says that Dan would be very demanding them to do whatever he wanted when he wanted it to. It started and continued in forms of he would send like a message, either an email or direct message of a slur. And if they didn't yell it out at the top of their lungs, they would get like scolded. They would get threatened or they would know that like they wouldn't be in his good graces. And we can't even say the words.
Yeah.
On here, I have to beep them, but just think of bad words and you get a message from your boss and it says, say this out loud or there's going to be some sort of repercussion. And you're just sitting at your desk trying to do your job and you have to say, beep, like,
okay,
in front of other people, mostly men. Just what? Why? It's the control.
Yeah.
Ugh. And exactly. You're writing a kid's show, dude. This isn't Sex in the City.
Yeah, like what kind of control do you need over
this
these people?
This is a kid. Make him yell out tomato, banana. Like, I don't know, dude. And this is the thing with all these like brilliant creator minds, okay? You're like, they're like, just let him cook. Just let him cook. This is the creative process. This is how he comes up with his best work. So a lot of people get away with that kind of stuff in these creative roles. Disgusting. Dan asked Christy to lean over the desk and act out and pretend that she was being but being essayed. violently.
Yeah. Wasn't there something that she didn't want to talk about too?
And this is in front of coworkers. This is in front of men. And he was pressuring her and pushing her and pushing her to do this. And she finally did it. How degrading, how traumatic, how embarrassing, disgusting from your boss. Imagine going to work tomorrow and doing that, having to do that.
Crazy.
And if you don't do it, your industry that you work in, your boss will blacklist you from the whole entire industry. With everything you know and your experience and your resume, you can't start fresh somewhere. They were absolutely pressured to do that.
It's crazy. I mean, I said it before in our little like live reaction though, but like, fuck that career, dog. Like, I mean, yes. It just in my brain.
But you do hold compassion and understand.
Yes.
How and why they couldn't do that at the time. Absolutely. And we don't know their situation.
They could have ended up homeless.
It sounded like they were very much paycheck to paycheck.
Yeah.
But let's think about grooming. This is a gradual process. And then one day you realize that you are in a position where you are acting out getting essayed on your desk. It wasn't the first day. And multiple things have happened. And then you find yourself doing a thing that you normally wouldn't do. There's groupthink. There's peer pressure. There's a power dynamic.
Yeah.
All of those things have to come into play. And looking back again at the bigger picture, they've been out of this role for how many years? And they're like, that really happened? Horrible.
Yeah.
And Jenny, she had a lot of really odd experiences with Dan. He was very much a bully to her. He also... She's the one that speaks about having to give Dan massages just all the time. Everyone was just always massaging Dan.
Yeah, it's just so weird. Dude. There's pictures of Amanda, like, touching
all
him.
All of them, all the kids, everybody.
Oh, my God.
Hire a masseuse.
Why do you need children's attention like that? It's just so fucking strange.
And your employees.
Go outside and go get a happy ending, bro, somewhere. Go hire a prostitute.
Jump off the flat earth.
Like, what the fuck are you doing? Lonely ass.
Disgusting creep.
Disgusting bitch.
And I don't even know if he, like, wanted a massage or liked, like, they're going to do what I say. I'm going
to
do.
Back to the control. Mm-hmm.
Disgusting. I'm well. Are you well?
I am not well.
We're getting through it.
I'm literally
dying. I know. We're getting through it. Woo. Shake it up. Okay.
No crash.
We're doing it. We're literally on slide 8. We're so close.
I know. I believe in us.
Yes. We're doing great. Cast members. We had so many speak out. A lot of them were from All That, one of my favorite shows growing up. Angelique Bates, she claims that she was physically, emotionally, and mentally abused, and her mother was. This also happened in front of her mother on the set.
Yep.
Even CPS was called to the set, and Angelique and her mom were pressured to stay quiet. Why was CPS called to the set?
That's insane.
I don't know, but I'm going to find out. More on All That. One of the characters, they named Penelope Taint, and Amanda was to play this character. They talk specifically about a scene where she's in the bed. Christy Stratton, one of the female writers, spoke up against this and was like, why? Why not Tate? Why not Tan? Why not Tom? Taint. And she speaks up and she's like, isn't that like a little bit gross?
Dan, just a little.
Dan gaslights the living everything out of her and says, why would your mind be going there? Why would you think that? No, like what?
It was literally like one letter off, dude.
It was was it?
No, they put a Y. It was like,
oh yeah, they're so
E-Y-A-N-T.
So clever.
That's so funny.
Why does she even need a last name? It's Amanda Show.
Penelope T, bro.
Penelope.
Penelope P.
Penelope P P P. And Jenny says that Dan told him in the writer's room to keep it a secret and don't let the kids know what it means. Obviously.
Can you imagine telling children
hey,
what that is?
We're going to name this character Penelope T. And this is what it means. Imagine.
I know this is kind of inappropriate, but I have to make this comment.
Let it rip.
Christy was explaining what a taint was. I lost my shit.
Oh,
she was like, it's the place between your...
Oh my God.
I was like, you really need to spell that out. We know.
Now we're adults.
The fact that that made the final edit of the documentary killed me, honestly.
They were like, this is gold. They're like, this is peak content right here. Thank you, Chrissy Stratton.
Thank you for your definition of a taint.
I love it.
So professional.
It'll go down in history.
Thank you.
I was just so disgusted.
Such a Webster's Merriam dictionary definition. Yeah. So good. Merriam-Webster? I don't fucking know. Whatever the dictionary is.
It was dictionaried.
It was so good.
Urban Dictionary. Leon Fearson describes his character, which was Captain Big Nose. Straight up.
An African-American child playing a
Captain
Big Nose.
First of all, that's just as it is.
Insane.
They put a big brown-colored prosthetic nose and put it all over his costume on the arms. Big old nose down below.
It looks like a dick.
And it's shaped as a two balls and a stick.
Yeah.
Okay?
So good.
It doesn't look like a nose. There's lots of ways to make a nose. I specifically remember like a big nose in one of the Nickelodeon games where they like put their arm up the nose and like goo comes out and there's like nose hair. Do you remember that? Or am I just
I think you're having
a little delusion?
No, I think you're right.
They know
how
to make a nose.
Yeah.
They didn't need to make it that shaped, but they sure did. And then looking back, the actor talks about a specific scene that really leaves him sick to his stomach. And it's where Captain Big Nose sneezes and the slime flies out onto the teacher or the person, the adult in the room. And it's very reminiscent of a very explicit act.
Yes.
And it's a reoccurring theme here with Schneider Productions.
Yes.
Which is actually, his company is called Schneider's Bakery. Just take me out. Oh. Schneider's Bakery.
I'm sorry, excuse me?
Schneider's Bakery?
What you baking, buddy?
Some shit. Baking up some bullshit.
Baking up some crazy ass psycho shit. Okay. Sick, bro. Sick name.
This is the quote from Leon, Captain Big Nose. You can't help but notice it looks like penises and testicles all over my shoulders. Because it was like his like armor, his superhero
it's
thing.
It's fucking weird. Just call him Penis Man, dude.
Yeah, Big Dick Man. Dude, like, really?
What the fuck?
And it's a child. Why, dude? And they had to.
And he thought it was all funny when
Dan. Dan is the one getting the laugh.
And even like I think with the two writers, they were like, he just found this stuff so fucking funny.
And it's not because it's funny on the surface level. A guy in a penis costume, it's a child, and it's the power. It's the power that Dan could make somebody do that, and that's what he is laughing at, aka getting aroused by, getting off on. I don't know if I can say that, but fuck it. Disgusting.
And that's a thing. People being turned on by power and control.
To feel something.
Yeah.
Reoccurring theme, huh?
Yeah, crazy.
I wish I could feel something.
Yeah, same.
I guess I know what I have to do, according to all this research here.
Yeah. Disgusting. I mean, I felt something this weekend, but.
Good. I'm so happy for you.
So good.
Good for you.
Okay.
Okay.
I didn't mean on that level, but.
I'm like, oh, I don't know what you mean, but I'm happy for you. Okay. I'm glad you felt something.
It was good.
That's really good. I love that for you a lot. Seriously.
It's so good.
My condolences.
Okay.
Okay. Brian Hearn was another actor on All That.
Which one was he again? Why am I
You'll
not
remember
remembering?
This. You'll remember. Okay. You'll remember. He talks about the racism that was on set that was played into with his character. And he was the one that was, are you remembering? Mm-hmm. It's coming back.
Yep.
He was cast as the Girl Scout cookie dealer as an African-American child. A sketch mimicking drug dealing.
It's so inappropriate.
And his skin tone was referred to as charcoal. I also believe he was the child who they put peanut butter all over and made dogs come and lick him. I don't remember if it was Leon, but it was another African-American child actor on set who they were always putting in like leotards. Oh my God, baby fetus. Do you remember that? That blew my mind, dude.
Dude, that was so fucking weird.
That was the weirdest thing of my life.
Fucking weird.
They had one of these children. Play a rapper called Little Fetus. And they put him in a bald cap. They put him in a complete... This is where they talked about the charcoal tone. So this
was... A complete nude leotard. Yep.
A full leotard. And he's just exposed, like, every part of him, right? And then they're like, we need to match his skin tone. And it's the color charcoal. And then they have, like, the clip. And it's, he's, like, in a fetal position as Little Fetus, being the youngest rapper alive. Like, who? Who? Take, like... Call 911 now. Like, I don't...
Call the FBI.
I'm going to jump out of the window.
Yeah.
Off Little Fetus, because that's just a great... Who thinks of that? A sick, twisted person. Kids don't know what a fetus is, dude.
Come on,
that's
man.
Not for a kid show. That's not a joke for a kid. It's not funny to a kid. We don't know what that means. We, like...
Do we even know what rappers are when we're kids? Like, we...
Little Fetus... And the whole thing of all that is it's like kids sketch comedy, right? Which is Mad TV, which is Saturday Night Live.
But those for are children.
Adult shows, dude. The fuck out of here, baby fetus. Gross. I want to go back and watch these fucking clips and just be like, what? That's all I know. That's all I know how to say. All right, Jennette McCurdy. We got to talk about some of the bigger names.
Okay.
Spoken out about the creator. She doesn't name Dan. The creator on the shows that she worked on. Okay.
Okay.
Who could that be?
Weird.
Schman Schneider, you know, like, come on. But she alleges the emotional abuse, the manipulation, and she was pressured into drinking alcohol underage, which is another reoccurring thing. And something that I learned recently about Nickelodeon is that a lot of them were drunk. They were pressured to drink in Victorious, which I didn't really watch because I think I was more in like the preteen or early teens.
Yeah.
I don't remember watching Victorious, but a lot of them came out and even said, admitted that they were drinking on set. To wrap up Jennette McCurdy, Jennette was also offered $300,000 to not say anything ever about Nickelodeon. And she gave them a big middle finger.
Suck my dick.
Yeah, she did that.
Literally.
She gave them that.
Yeah.
Ariana Grande. Honorable mention. Some people may know her.
You know, she's a little popular.
We've seen the videos. If you haven't, look them up. Do not look them up. Don't.
Don't give this any more attention.
Very, very inappropriate scenarios with different objects. Zoe 101, Jamie Lynn Spears, and Alexa Nicholas. Very inappropriate scenes. All of these young girls are put into scenes doing very explicit, disgusting, uncomfortable scene.
Like Ariana Grande in her foot though, too.
The toe in the mouth. A child.
Why?
Because Dan thinks that kids think feet are so funny. Disgusting.
Keep that shit to yourself, my man.
My
honestly.
Man. Take it away.
Take it the fuck
from children.
Go subscribe to a feet fetish website.
Like, that doesn't do it. It's the power.
It's just so crazy.
It doesn't do it.
Because
he can buy it. He can buy anything he wants, but it's not doing it for him.
No, just not hitting.
Not hitting like that underage employee kind of trauma and torture. It's a different kind of feeling.
I guess.
I would assume. Disgusting.
Yeah.
So they have her in these two shots that really stick out to me. Ariana Grande, we got the toe in the mouth. We have a part where she is told to try and get the juice out of a potato. It's a very long, narrow potato. You get the image. And then another one where she is hanging upside down off her bed, like with her head like towards the floor, pouring a water bottle, like trying to drink water upside down.
Her mouth open.
The water is going everywhere. She's in revealing clothing. Like all these girls are in this spaghetti straps and short skirts. And Dan was so involved with wardrobe. He would be in there and needed approval. It's just so foul.
That Alexa chick even said like, he was, like, making girls appeal to the male gaze. Yeah. Why are we making underage girls
appeal to anyone?
Appeal to any fucking man. That's just...
Oh, anything.
Anything.
No.
No.
Just a
zero.
T-shirt.
Zero appeal.
A soccer jersey. Who cares?
Yeah. Put him in some...
We don't need bikinis. We don't need spaghetti straps. We don't need tube tops. We don't need bathing suits.
We don't need cute chokers. We don't need makeup. Like, that's crazy.
We don't need our toes painted and in our mouth. So we get a statement from Dan. All of this stuff comes out. Someone sends me this. I could tell you right now, you could have told me that was Jesus Christ himself. I did not think that was Dan Schneider. first of all, he's apologizing. Second of all, he looks scary. And he did before, but now he looks so scary. I don't know what it is. He's just scary to me now. He was scary then, but he was more in his youth. So I don't know if he lost weight. I don't know if he's sick. He just did not look like Dan to me.
Well, karma, motherfucker.
It's catching up.
Coming for you, bitch.
And this is what Dan says. I was wrong. I apologize to anybody that I ever put in that situation. And even additionally, I apologize to the people who were walking around Video Village or wherever that happened, because there were lots of people who were there to witness it who may have also felt uncomfortable. So apologizing for his actions, apologize. He said he was wrong. Apologizing for the people that he has harmed and to the people who may have witnessed it. Nobody believes him.
Yeah.
But he hit all the marks of what we would normally accept as an apology. He's also deflected everything, saying it went through the chains of command. It went through this and it went through that. And all these people approved it. Like, he's still not.
It's been excuses up to this point. Yeah. So, and like, this apology
one
to me,
time, maybe.
Yeah.
10 years.
Not dog.
Of the same shit.
Not dog.
Absolutely not. Drake Bell. He's got some allegations of his own. He has been accused of talking to an underage girl.
A couple DUIs.
Yep. The accusation is that Drake had groomed this child about 14, and he was like getting close to 30 or something. It was like a big difference. It was big. He did plead guilty to felony attempted child endangerment and a misdemeanor charge of disseminating matter harmful to juveniles. Weird charges. I don't really know what all of that means. The charges stemmed from his online conduct with an underage fan where he exchanged explicit messages with her and engaged in reckless and irresponsible behavior. Despite the victim's accusations of sexual conduct, Bell's guilty plea did not involve charges related to physical contact. As a result of this plea deal, Bell received 2 years probation and a suspended 1-year jail sentence and was ordered to complete 200 hours of community service. He also has been accused by an ex-partner of being abusive and some domestic violence stuff going on there. I wanted to get that out because he is a victim in this case, but he has also caused harm. And he is now being more public. He's getting on TikTok. While we can hold space for him and what he went through as a child, we can still acknowledge that he has also harmed people too.
Yeah, and there's no excuse. I mean, it's like a common theme, right? People who abuse have been abused.
Yes,
and
people hurt people.
Yeah, exactly. And that's never an excuse. Like, you deal with your shit, and, you know, a lot of people deal with the hurt in their lives and in normal, healthy ways.
And don't hurt others.
And don't hurt others.
Yeah, not everybody who has been hurt will continue that.
Yeah.
But the pattern shows that.
And it makes sense.
Yes, that these types of people who are harming have usually had something done to them that way.
And I can be compassionate for that. I really can. Because I'm sure he's kept this in for, I mean, how many years now?
A very long time. Since 2003.
Yeah.
So we'll talk about Brian Peck. Some might know him as Pickle Boy.
I really can't with this man.
Scum of the earth.
Yeah, not even a man. A disgusting pile of fucking shit.
Not even a human. Not even a human. A speck of shit.
Just
bye.
Bye.
Brian Peck is a convicted sex offender, former actor, dialogue coach, director, and producer on Nickelodeon, who was arrested in 2003 for child SA. He faced charges of lewd acts with a minor, sodomy, oral copulation by anesthesia or controlled substance, and other related offenses. Peck was convicted on 2 counts in 2004 and sentenced to serve 16 months.
I fucking cannot. Anesthesia? So he was also drugging? Oh my God.
And when Drake is finally speaking out and telling his story, he's like, he can't even say what actually happened.
Yeah, he can't even say it.
They do show some of the court documents in the documentary. I'm sure those are also available online if you really are needing to know exactly what happened. But in his own words, he says, just think of the worst possible thing that you can think of, and that's what happened to me. From Drake Bell, I was just trapped. I had no way out. The abuse was extensive, and it got pretty brutal. I don't know how to elaborate on that on camera, really. just think of the worst stuff that someone could do to somebody as an essay, and then that'll answer the question. I don't know how else to put it. Gets out of jail. So 16 months, year and a half, right? And that was in 2004. So 2005 and a half. And before we get off the topic of him to wrap this episode, the John Wayne Gacy custom artwork from prison.
You got me so fucked up. That dude was obsessed with him. That is so fucking weird.
With letters.
So from prison. Weird.
Sis pal. They're just pals.
Just a little
two peas in a fucking pedophile pod.
Yep. Little psycho little pods that they're in together.
Disgusting. So 16 months in 2004. That's giving us about 2005 and a half. Guess where he starts working in 2006?
Disney.
Hired at Disney.
Fucking no.
How?
How do you go to prison for felonies of that nature and someone just hires you?
Not someone.
Disney. Yeah.
On a kids television show, The Sweet Life of Zach and Cody.
Well, there's workers or like there's like people who come out of prison with felonies and they can barely get jobs. This motherfucker steps up to Disney's plate.
This scum of the earth.
Yo.
And meanwhile, the two women writers
can't get a job. A salary. Can't get a job half either. A salary. After this.
Abuse the child.
Career ended.
You're good. Come on in. We got room.
For it here.
Take a little felon. It's fine. So he's at Disney. They find out eventually, or they get enough backlash that they get him off the set. But Disney is no golden angel in this whole situation.
How long was he there for? Do you know?
I don't
before
know
he got
exactly.
Fired.
It they framed it as shortly after. But come
but
on.
But you hired him and to come begin with.
On. Like, if it was a day, that's too
accountability.
Many.
Accountability.
A day is too many.
Accountability.
So I want to know. I'm going to look up when we're done when he was hired on in 2006 and when he was let go.
Because if it's any longer than 24 hours, we're done.
If it's longer than 2 seconds, I'm out.
I mean, exactly. With but that, why even I'm hire out. Him in the fucking first place?
Literally.
That's so crazy.
Background check, fingerprints, newspaper. Have you read an article? Have you seen
you
TMZ?
You work in the same industry. You got me so fucked up that you haven't heard. No.
Everyone's
no
just,
dog.
They're blind. They're,
no
they can't
dog.
Hear. They can't see. They don't read.
Everyone's
they don't
related
go outside.
In that shit. Everyone's family.
They
no
don't
friends.
Know anything.
No, you got me
no,
so
no,
fucked.
No. They're good. They're all good. They're all good. It's very scary to think of it in that way.
And I don't think we'll ever really know the impact truly because, like, how do you
gauge that?
How do you measure something like that, honestly? And what kids absorbed and what?
How do you know? Unless it's all some sick study that some scientists and people
we're
have started from the beginning and they put out Nickelodeon to see our generation to see where we end up. I don't know, man. I'm just saying.
Millennials giving, got some problems.
It's giving sus. And you know where I'm at mentally right now. Anything is possible in my brain at this point.
We love a good conspiracy.
Man, I'm mind blown. Heartbroken.
Yeah.
Confused. Sickened. There's only one thing that we can rate, though, and that's the scale of suspicion. And I want to talk about child actors in these networks and shows as a whole. Not just Dan. We know what Dan did. Not just Brian. We know what Brian did. The whole
all
shebang
of
Hollywood, of these child actors, of the grooming, of the exposure to millions of people.
Absolutely.
Call 911.
Call the FBI.
Call my mom. I'm scared.
Wee-oo.
Thank you so much for listening to another episode of It's Giving Sus. We'll be back every Monday with another one. We're tired as
I'm
all
so
hell.
I'm so surprised Meg's I got through like, this. I'm literally dying.
But thank you so much. If you have not subscribed yet, please do so. It is free. We are excited to hit the 500 mark.
Oh
so we can.
God.
Yes, it's going to happen quick. It's going to happen really quick. We can open up our shop. Get some merch, some like extra cozy oversized stuff and like cozies. Like I'm only things that I would personally wear, I'm gonna put out like the coziest, softest, oversized, all of it. Like nothing I wouldn't have and I just want it for myself. So even if you guys don't buy it, but that'll be available once we hit 500. And then our followers, our people who view can leave us super likes and super chats, which is awesome. And I can't wait. It's going to come up really fast. So we're getting ready.
Super exciting.
We're getting ready. So please follow, like, subscribe, share, leave a comment. Let us know what you think. Let us know about these crazy theories and like,
are we crazy?
Yeah, just like, honestly, are we? I think we've lost it. I've gone off the rails, but that's okay. That's okay. We're here to talk.
We can get back on eventually.
We're here to talk it through. That's why we have this. So, thank you for being here. Thank you for watching another episode of It's Giving Sus. And until next time, stay curious and stay skeptical.
Bye.